Welcome to Sandbox AQ Studios. We're here with Ed Wang, a practitioner of financial services and banking for decades, somebody who looks at it not only as a financial expert, but also in a way as a scientist, somebody who understands the deep economic relationships and dynamic and mathematical relationships in the economy and in financial markets. Ed, it's great to have you here with me today. We've already had quite a bit of impact in the world, but looking forward for more. Ed, start with your background. You've been in financial services banking for decades now and have a lot of experience seeing trends come and go. When you look at the trend of AI, how do you see it from the lens of someone who's really analyzed what really impacts the economy?
Thank you, Jack. Good to be with you. So as a financial markets practitioner and a student of economics and science, I believe that there's a great parallel between what we see in what's been called the fourth industrial revolution and what we saw in finance. As Mike Milken, as you and I both know, cited, the great revolution in financial markets was math. Similarly, I think math and high performance compute, as that intervenes in the trajectory that you've taken, has just astounding implications for everything about finance, but in all of the real physical markets that financial markets mirror. So this
And just to expound on that for a second, you and I have talked about this, that the insight that Jensen and the NVIDIA team had right from the 90s, from the beginning, is that math could drive better video game performance and video game graphics. And that math, encoded in CUDA, which sits on top of the GPU, drove a revolution in video graphics, of course, but then NVIDIA became central to the entire economy. So let's get back to this theme you talked about, the centrality of math, first in a revolution in financial services, not just in terms of high-frequency trading and traditional quant finance, but the entire gamut of financial services. Talk about that a little bit, and then, yeah, let's talk about AI.
Well, it's certainly, I think, no coincidence that we're sitting here in Davos WEF 2025, and the thematic headline is collaboration in the age of intelligence. Because when you speak to the intelligence of now math, computational chemistry, as obviously is such an exciting cornerstone for Sandbox AQ, molecular biology, and of course physics, which is really, you know, I think bookends of your forte. The integration and impact of these technologies, disciplines, and learning systems coming together with HPC and all of the great things that we see happening at a pace that we can't even begin to fathom, which I'd really like to hear more about from you. I believe that all of that compression and impact is truly extraordinary, unprecedented in history.
Yeah, it's wild to see that. When you look at the different parts of the financial sector, you have investment banks, commercial banks, investment funds, both the long-only traditional funds as well as the long-short and multi-strat managers now that have emerged with quite a bit of assets. Blackstone has surpassed the $1 trillion mark. And others are growing as well, Millennium and many others. When you look at insurance, when you look at the gamut of financial services, which parts of the financial services markets do you see adopting technology faster? Which ones do you think still have a ways to go?
Well, clearly those that have the most exposure, capital at risk, if you will. You know, JP Morgan obviously pioneered the whole valuation at risk metric for understanding risk. But any entity, individual, family, institution, hedge fund, what have you, that is in the business of managing risk is rife and rampant for this kind of disruption and will have to be ahead, cannot be behind. And the pace and acceleration and momentum at which all of this is taking place implies that truly when you say you're AI or die, that is more than just a watchword or shibboleth, that is reality. And so I think when you think about the frontier bleeding edge, if you will, in finance, it clearly would be, you know, those that, you know, are your high frequency trading systems and platforms, of course, as we've already witnessed. But any of your major money center universal banking institutions are obviously, I think, would really be heads in the sand if they were not engaging and adopting at scale today. And scale, you know, lastly, I think is really going to be the driving force, you know.
And you look at scale, for example, Ed, you and I have talked about Citadel, Ken Griffin, the adoption of math as a core element of what he has built at Citadel and all its subsidiaries, and the number of PhDs and quant folks in there. Two Sigma, another investor in SandboxAQ, David Siegel, personally, not Two Sigma the fund, but from his family office. But again, David exemplifying the leveraging of math and equations in the finance area. And let's turn to another aspect, which you mentioned the word frontier. As we think about deep tech, frontier tech, be it in AI, biotech, space, we've seen a major shift in asset allocation. We used to think of these areas as being funded by folks, maybe some individual high net worth folks who really believed in this and maybe made their money in tech. But we're seeing a big shift. T. Rowe Price invested in SandboxAQ. We're seeing BlackRock, Fidelity, and others making their investments in other frontier tech companies, in biotech, in space tech, and other companies like that. We're seeing family offices make a big shift. We used to think of family offices as being very conservative, the most conservative. You know, we just put our stuff in T-bills. That's all we do here at the family office. And now they're seeing it as a conservative approach, investing in deep tech companies. And what we're hearing from them, I'm curious to what you're hearing, is that they like deep tech, one, because of the deep moat around the castle. When you invest in a deep tech company, you're going to hold off on commoditization for years to come because of that moat around the castle. They like the fact that with deep tech, you can invest not just single digit millions, but hundreds of millions, right? Because you're building something very large, very impactful in the global economy. What are you seeing? What are you hearing as you speak to family offices, as you speak to large scale funds, the BlackRocks of the world? What are you seeing about this shift in asset allocation?
I think any intelligent investor would be loath to ignore the force of AI and now quantum computing in recent weeks, which has garnered so many headlines. And by the way, as you speak of the intelligent family of SandboxAQ cap table, we should also not ignore that we have many successful practitioners and those who have solved the market. The man who solved the market, actually, I believe the attribution went to James Simons. But in fact, I think the other bookend would be Mr. Ray Dalio, who's obviously with us here this week and a new investor in SandboxAQ. And I think endemic and reflective of this reality, which is if we're to understand probabilistic versus deterministic, that whole calculus of how we understand markets. I mean, you know, I know you've talked about biology and computational chemistry with great passion, but when we think about markets, that very much is a quantum phenomenon.
High dimensional. Simulating millions, if not billions, of portfolios, risk management, tail risk.
Pre-training, post-training, test time scaling, and all of that. So that integration, it would seem to me that the financial markets, you know, globally, really are truly a good test case and really fertile ground. And when we think about what we are hearing from practitioners in the space, I don't think anyone is ignoring this. And all are playing catch up. And all are, I think, slow at their own peril, you know, to this very point.
Excellent. Well, Ed, it's great to be with you here. More to come. This is the first of many conversations. And I think when we talked about global impact, we are talking about the largest sectors. 80%+ of the GDP of the economy, of course, is impacted by math, by the quantitative relationships that you and I have been talking about here. Language AI, certainly a massive impact, cutting costs, But in terms of value creation, be it in portfolio management or be it in biology, biopharma, other sectors, quantitative is really where it's at. And so I'm really glad we had the chance to sit down today and look forward to our next conversation.
Thank you, Jack.
Thanks, Ed.